Today's episode is sponsored by Houston's Training and Fitness Center in our hometown of Harrow, Ontario. Recently purchased by Mike and Jamie Houston, it is located in the same building as the Harrow Arena. For only $30 a month, you can be a member of a judgment-free gym with everything you need for a great workout. They also have personal training available with certified strength and conditioning trainers, sick custom apparel like hats, shirts, hoodies, and more. They even stock some Canadian protein supplements like pre-workout and protein in a variety of flavors. Check them out at www.houstonstfc.com or visit them on Instagram and Facebook to learn more.
And what is going on, everybody? It is episode number 57 of Hat Trick Hockey, which is always brought to you by our good friends over at GL Heritage, the official beer of Hat Trick Hockey. And if you like my shirt right here, if you like that, you can just go on any of our posts, click the link, bring you right into our merch store where you can get all your sweet HTH merch from our friends over at Laser Art. Rob, this being episode number 57, this is the fucking Tyler Myers edition. He was drafted 12th overall by the Sabres in 08. He's played 13 years in the league, 758 games, 86 goals, 221 assists, 307 points, World Junior Gold. He's won WHL Championship, and also in the 2010 season, he was the NHL Rookie of the Year. Good stats. Bring in my boy, my line mate, Rob. How was your weekend, buddy?
Good. Is that good, though, that Tyler Myers?
Yeah, he's still playing. Still playing. That's crazy. He's a tall bastard, too, that guy. He's huge.
Yeah, he's a beast. I had a great weekend. I had my cornhole finals. Didn't do so well. Kind of shit the bed. But
what happened?
You win as a team, you lose as a team.
What right happened?
We had it set up that we were in good graces with the cornhole gods and just couldn't get it done. It was fucking horrible.
Oh man, that's crazy.
Lose the first one, win the second one, lose the third one. Done. We're out. But that being said, we did finish 6 out of 20. So
that's pretty good.
Yeah, yeah.
Top 10, baby.
Top 10.
What else you do?
So, then, you know, I go to those Meg Club meetings on Fridays, you know, mm-hmm. just solve all world problems there. Mm-hmm. And, we end up getting after it and going to Ricky Garon's for some drinky poos. And I met a whole bunch of people that listen to the show.
Awesome.
And it was awesome. They're all great people. I didn't even know half of them listened to the show, but I knew like three quarters of them. That's but awesome. They're all great, great locals. You know, we had a blast, and then love we it. Ended up closing up the Peacock.
The Peacock. The Peacock. I got to go there with you one night. I haven't even went yet.
Bro, it was awesome. It's kind of like an episode from Friends, but not drinking coffee. You're drinking beers and shit, and there's couches. Yeah. It's awesome. I love the bar. I love the bar.
That is pretty sweet.
I'm going to get them as a sponsor, too. I promise you that.
We could definitely do some interviews and stuff in there. That'd be pretty cool. We like doing that.
Great. It would be great.
Sick. What else you do?
All those people that don't like the Peacock because it's it's more the people say, oh, it's a biker bar. It's a, you know what? Nobody fucks with bikers. If you don't fuck with them, they won't fuck with you.
Yeah.
You know, and you're probably in the safest place.
Definitely. Definitely.
So they grab you. You start being an ass and they just, they fire you out.
Done and done.
Yep. Yep.
That's hilarious. What else is it? Or is that it? Or
spent yesterday poolside with Misty. I had another rough go there Friday night. So
just probably something you ate again.
Didn't do too much on Saturday. Took it kind of easy peasy. And Sunday, spent at poolside. Oh man, what a beautiful day. Like nice and warm. Pool was just refreshing.
Yeah.
It was just at a perfect 80 degrees. So
wetting
balls, jump in, cool off. Yeah, yeah. It was awesome. Me and Misty were floating around on the floaties, and I think she might have fallen asleep. Bet she didn't, but I really think she did. But yeah, fun. All in all, it was a great weekend. You went to play some ball, eh?
Oh, let me fucking tell you. Oh, well, so we go up Friday night, me, Steph, and the kids, and so we go up, and so we get an 8:30 draw. So we win our first game, we lose our second game, and then we won our third game. Here's the thing. Those three games were played back to back to back. Out of all the years I've played fucking Super Series, I've never played back to back to back games to open up a tournament. If we would have lost, we would have been out by like noon. Like we would have been done by noon. Thankfully we didn't, but so this is what kills me about Super Series. Okay. It drives me insane. So we play a team, by the way, shout out to all the Angels out there, cause these guys fucking battled this weekend. It was hot as fuck. So it turned out, so we win win, lose, win. And then this team comes back to play us. The team we played the first game comes back to play us. They're now 0-2. We're 2-1. And if they beat us, we're out. Ain't that some shit? So we're like, thankfully again, we beat them. So now we're 3-1. And then we play.
So then they would have been what? 2-1.
They would have been what? The team that we beat the third game or the fourth game? The fourth game was a team that we played the first game.
Right.
So they were, but when they came back, they were 0-2 and we had played three.
Right.
But yeah, if they would have won that game against us, they would have knocked us out and they would have been 1-2 and still in. Okay. So that's how weird it is. Okay. So we play one of the other Windsor teams. Bowery. So we played them. We won 17-16. So then we went on to the next game and we were just out of gas, man. Like we were 4-1. We had played five games. We were dead
on the Saturday.
So we played pretty much back to back to back to back games, like almost all day. We had like maybe an hour break. Like we were barely getting enough time to like go grab something to drink or take a piss or grab something to eat quick. Like we didn't get a lot of time. Like they didn't, it was shitty for us. And so we were like, how does this work? Like, so the team, so I look up yesterday, the team that lost in the finals was 4-2. We were 4-2. Like, you know what I mean? It's a complete mess. Like, I don't know how they should just go back to the way it was, or it was just like a straight up 2-game knockout. You lose two games, you're done.
You know who should set up the schedule? Evan Balarjan.
I know. I agree. He's an absolute G when it comes to that.
You know what's funny? It's so funny that you guys all drive up there. And how many teams from Windsor are in your division?
I think like five or six. Five? Right. I think five. Yeah.
You guys couldn't do that here?
We could have our own circuit here.
Right. Like, I don't understand why you got to go all the way up to London and then get fucking hosed and then come all the way back here.
Yeah. The thing is, though, is like,
you could set that up in McGregor every weekend almost.
Yeah. But you luckily, know, there's a luckily, whatever. Yeah. Luckily, there was only four events this year. So, but it's just nuts. But yeah. So I'm sore as hell today. I played every inning of every game. So my thighs hurt. My hips are hurting. My shoulder hurts. Like, I was like, man, I can't keep doing this shit much longer, man. Like, I don't want to wake up sore after I play a sport. It sucks, but I love it though.
So I quit ball and I just golf now. And the only thing I wake up hurting is my head.
I'm going to slowly transition into that. But yeah, that's pretty much how it went. And then just Sunday, we just spent poolside. So
nice.
It was good.
At mom and pa's.
Yeah. we ended up stayed over into Sunday anyways. Like, we played our last game at like 6 o'clock. So we pretty much played from 8:30 to 6, like all day, 6 games. Good times. But then, yeah, so we
never played 6 games in one day in London.
It sucks, dude. It sucks. Yeah, and then Sunday we were just by the pool all day, so it was good. And then, but shall we?
Let me ask you this. Yeah. Let me ask you this. Was the tournament just a one-day event?
No. If we would have won at 6 o'clock, we would have had to play again at 8:30, and if we would have won that game, then we would have got in the Sunday. So we would have had to been 6-1 to go into Sunday and then turn around on Sunday and have to win 5 more straight to win it.
That's fucking bananas.
So we would have had to been 11-1 to win that tournament. Like, you know what I mean? It's just like, I don't get it, but shout out though, those boys, man, we fucking battled this weekend, and we was probably 3 times we were down by 8 or more and came back.
Did Nate Grant go up with you?
Yeah, Nate was up there. We had like pretty much full squad.
Nice.
So it was all hands on deck, but yeah. So the boys grinded it out, but it's going to take a while to heal up here. So let's go to the hockey. Let's
do some hockey.
I seen today, Kata Hat is how they say it, right? Signed a new 3-year deal, 3-year extension in Philly, $11.9 million. I would say that's pretty well where you thought it would be, no? Or do you think it'd be higher? So he's like almost $4 million a year.
Okay, let me ask you this. Did he have a great year last year?
He was decent.
But weren't there all kinds of, like, everybody was up in the air, oh, has he lost it? Like, I remember that at the beginning of the year where he was struggling.
Mm-hmm. Well, and they didn't exactly have a big scoring punch either, too, right? Like, they had a kind of an off year. Like, Philly's normally big and tough and fast, and
James Van Riemsdyk, he had a save percentage of .877.
Yeah, that's an off year.
He had a 3.67
goals against. How many games did he play?
9 wins, 11 losses, 5 ties.
Oh, ouch. So and okay.
So they're expecting a big bounce back here.
Yeah, big bounce back.
Right, but so that. But what it, how much did he get?
He got about just under four a year.
4 a year, yeah. So I guess that's not bad.
It's not horrible.
I think, but you better hope he has a Binnington year next year.
He's due for a breakout year, I'll tell you that. Wouldn't you say so?
I don't know. I thought he had his breakout year last year.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe. Well, last year was kind of a weird year too, right? Shortened season, yeah. COVID, shit like that. Maybe freaking coming in with a fresh start, new deal, everything. Maybe he'll be like good to go. He'll lock in.
Last year he was 24-13 and 3, and he had a save percentage of .914, and he had a goals against at his best year in the 3 years that he's played for at 2.42. So that's a kind of a big shift change, right? Mm-hmm. So I don't know.
We're going to find out. Only time will tell, man.
Right.
Did you see too, John Cooper, Lightning head coach, is named the 2022 Team Canada head coach for the Olympics.
And congratulations. And so he should be.
Yeah. So that's kind of straightforward, right? Back-to-back Stanley Cups. Like, come on. And
yeah,
like, and, who knows?
The assistant coaches are Peter DuBoer and the bald guy that was a coach in Washington, and
Bruce Boudreau,
Montreal at one time.
Bruce Boudreau.
Boudreau, yeah. And there was one more. I can't remember, like, off the top of my head who it was, but
still, look at that staff.
That's right, a hell of a coaching staff, right?
Jesus. I would say so. Are you seeing everything I'm seeing online right now, Rob, is Jack Eichel, Jack Eichel, Jack Eichel, everything. Are you seeing all this stuff on him?
No, I don't follow.
Oh, dude. Okay. Drop something there. So it appears that the Rangers, Kings, Bruins, and Ducks are the ones that appear to be in on him right now.
Yep.
But however, they're saying that the Rangers are the front runner. So with them being the front runner, there's names like Kaapo Kakko, Georgiev, Lafreniere, Zibanejad. Like some of those names could be involved in the deal with picks, I would assume, or future considerations, or, you know, all that crazy stuff that they do in these deals, right?
But not all together. Not all together.
No. You won't see all those guys like in on the deal. But you might see like one or two and some draft picks.
Right.
Because let's
Kaapo Kakko.
Kaapo Kakko, yeah. Love it. But they were saying that that like they're really interested in draft picks. Like Buffalo wants a lot of draft picks.
What? So they can ruin it. A whole bunch more careers, like
so, just so they could try to rebuild with young kids. Mm. So I don't know. What would you think seeing one of those guys involved in a deal, especially like Lafreniere? Like imagine that. You get drafted first overall. You play like a year, year and a half, or whatever, 2 years in the NHL for the Rangers, and then you get dealt to Buffalo.
So why can't it go, you know, our first round for your first round? I get it. He's established now. Eichel is a fucking demon. Mm-hmm. He's a beast. But
he has neck issues too, though.
And Lafreniere has knee issues, mm-hmm. right? So I'll trade you one knee for a neck.
I don't. That's either a limb or your neck. Like,
right. I'll trade you my knee for your neck.
Oh, that's brutal. You said
anybody could. The career could be over, right? Like yeah. One hit, one knee on knee. You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
Who knows?
Yeah, who
knows? Oh, yeah. I would be. Yeah, I would be a little weary about trading for Eichel.
Mm-hmm. That's what I mean. That's what why a lot of teams.
Obviously.
But that's why a lot of teams are really hesitating because of that neck, man. Like if he has to have surgery, that's months out, like months.
You got to pass your physical, right?
Yeah. So
I don't have to do shit. I can bring him in and my doctor is going to go up and down you know.
Yeah. But think about rehab and stuff, though.
There's going to be a lot of probing.
Hey, but like, think about rehab on a neck, man.
No.
That can't be like weeks. Like, that's probably months.
I didn't like rehab on my ankle and it really broke.
Imagine it on your neck. Wouldn't be fun. You said there was a Ottawa Senators goalie that retired. Which one was that again?
Ah, fuck. I just saw been in the league quite a while too, right? Just scrolling. Here it is. Anders Nielsen retires after he retired at 31 due to post-concussion syndrome.
Oh
yeah.
I hate seeing guys have to leave the league for that.
Well, you know what? I played goalie once in my entire life. I got hit in the calf with the puck. I said, no more.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys are taking shots in the head. Guys crashing the net. You know what I mean? Like, how the fuck? I couldn't imagine being a goalie. But, you know, there's a lot of awesome guys out there that do play that game. And you know what? People should respect a goalie because without goalies, you don't have a game.
Imagine getting those ones off the collarbone. Those are the ones that I think would be the worst.
No, I broke my collarbone and I didn't like that.
No, it sucks. It sucks. Also, Patty Maroon.
Hold on one second, though. He's had stints with the New York Islanders, the St. Louis Blues, the Edmonton Oilers, the Vancouver Canucks, and the Buffalo Sabres. That's where he got fucking Buffalo.
Yeah. Always blame it on Buffalo, eh, Rob? Hey, so
it's the all they don't have the all dress chips. I'm telling you.
Hey, so Patty Maroon is like, love his game. So he was saying that there's like a good chance that they could fucking three-peat. Do you think they could? Here's the thing though, man, that third line, who was on that third line? It was Gord. I don't know, but there was three, their third line. I'm trying to think who the other two were. It's completely slipping my mind, but I know Gord was one of them. But their third line during the playoffs was huge for them.
Yeah.
Like
they were the best third line, I think, in the playoffs.
Yeah, but now they don't have any of them.
No, Gord's gone, right?
But the other two are gone too. I'm trying to think who it is. It's slipping my mind. I had it in my head too, but I know Gord is one of them for sure. But they had like, do you think they can do it without those guys? Because those guys were key. But then again, they brought in Corey Perry.
Yanni Gord they lost, Tyler Johnson they lost, Blake Coleman they lost, Gord they lost.
I think those are the three. That's the one.
Corey Perry, mm-hmm. Zach Bogosian.
Yeah.
Pierre Balmieri. Balmieri. I don't fucking know.
It's just nice to hear you butcher names for once.
Oh yeah.
I love it.
So, yeah. I don't know. If Fat Pat gets out there, I think they'll be all right.
I'd put him with Corey Perry.
That would be a beast of a line there. There's going to be so many penalties.
Put those two together, let them go out there and just wreak havoc on the league. Dude,
I cannot believe that Montreal let Corey Perry go. I can't.
Maybe they wanted to sign him and he got a...
Of anybody on that team.
Maybe he didn't want to sign there.
Next to Carey Price.
Yeah. I just mean, maybe he didn't want to sign.
Yeah.
It's possible, right?
Well, I'm going to go live in Tampa Bay or I'm going to live in Montreal.
Yeah. And you'd probably have a better shot at winning the cup in Tampa, right?
Well, one, you got beautiful weather. The other one, you got
8 feet of snow.
pole dancers, the strippers.
That's fine.
I wouldn't know.
Me neither. Hey, did you see the ticket fucking Darnell Nurse got?
I did not.
Ginormous tick. 8 years, 74 mil. Kenny Holland loves flinging out those big deals, eh?
Wow.
That's a lot of dough.
That guy is a fucking beast. What is
that
he,
one?
Like six? Like, the guy's enormous.
That one game that they had, that one.
Probably like, one of the meanest guys, too, out there, right?
Oh, he scraps out. He'll fight anybody. Remember that one game that they had that was, like, super long during, like, he played, like, 60 minutes or something the one night.
Yeah, he played a full game.
Yeah, like that's nuts, dude. I'd be throwing up, be all cramped up. That'd be, but so
he's gonna make 9.25 million a year, right?
9.25 a year. Would you think he's worth that, or do you think it's a little bit of an overpayment?
I don't know. He only trails Eric Karlsson and Drew Doughty for Seth Jones.
He's a paid defenseman. He's a force, man.
Eric Karlsson makes 11.5 million. Drew Doughty makes 11.
Karlsson has fell off. You hardly heard about him last year.
What is it? Zach Warnowski? Warnowski?
Warenski?
Warenski.
Yeah. Columbus Blue Jackets?
Minus two. Yeah. 9.58.
Yeah. He's worth every cent, every penny.
Seth Jones make 9.5.
Yeah.
But remember what I said. You can't win a cup if you have a $10 million player. Hasn't happened in history.
Yeah. Oh, did you see frickin'
freaking tartar sauce there.
Signed signed a 2-year deal with the Devils, $9 million for 4.5 per. The Habs had him fucking health bombed half the time.
Yeah, he was a healthy scratch a bunch of times.
He hardly played.
I can understand it. He's a hell of a hockey player.
He is.
But you know,
his hands are ridiculous.
What's the GM's name?
What's that?
What's the GM's name there?
And where? New Jersey?
In Montreal.
Red suit. Bergevin?
Yeah. Does Bergevin make the guy sit, or does the coach make the guy sit?
I would imagine it's the coach making a lineup decision.
And then they lost.
Yeah. He's got, man, I
thought he was a hell of a hockey player.
I loved him with the Wings. He was awesome there. I kind of wish they would almost brought him back on like a 1-year deal or something like that. You know what I mean? See what happens.
Well, the Tartar had the sauce, right?
He does. And also, before we go into our interview here, you've seen too that Marc-Andre, like Fleury, was up in the air about just calling it quits in hockey when he got traded into the Blackhawks, eh? Like, he was really contemplating it.
Okay, so actually, before he got traded, he was contemplating quitting, retiring.
Yeah, just done.
So it had nothing to do with Montreal. I read the story on it, and he said it had nothing to do. But now that he's in Chicago.
Yeah.
Now that he's in Chicago, loves it.
How sick is he gonna look in fucking in those jerseys? And you know he's gonna like, they're gonna be a legit contender again, man. Having him in net is huge. And then you got Jonathan Toews is gonna hopefully be back, and Kane and the Doc brothers, and I think the Jones brothers are there now too, right? We were talking about them too. Like, they're gonna be freaking, they're gonna be good. They're going to have their vets. They're going to have speed. They're going to have goaltending. They're going to have fucking goal scoring.
Well, they dumped that big old contract with Duncan Keith.
Yeah. When he went over to the Oilers, he got another huge ticket over there. I think we talked about that a couple episodes ago. But yeah, man, like, it's going to be interesting, man. It's going to be interesting. Chicago, look out. Get excited. Now's the time, because it's going
to
be.
And we're right around the corner. And another thing I wanted to tell you is that the 73s camp opens up on the hold on 1 second.
You think they'll let us go in there and watch some of the scrimmages?
I think we're kind of connected now. So yeah, the 10th or no, sorry. What has he got?
His regular season starts early October for them, right? Or mid-October. Right.
But I sent a message to it's the 17th and the 19th.
Of this month?
Yep.
Really, eh? That quick.
So next Tuesday and the Tuesday after that.
No, see, the boys are back.
Yep.
And I'm going.
I'm going to watch.
Yeah, we're definitely going to some games. We got to maybe...
I'm going to go watch the mini camps.
I want to too.
We'll backdoor it. We'll figure it out.
Hey, Rob?
Who wants some?
I got a shirt to the fucking heavyweight champ out here. Blood free. I'll give it to you after.
Oh, I'm very excited. I'm very excited to see some local hockey. You
too, and I'm... excited to be able to go there and watch
the boys. We've met and we've talked to all these guys, and they're all total beauts. You know, like, yeah. I can't wait to get out to Wheatley and Lee and Amherstburg and what was the other one?
Going on tour. We're going on tour.
Yeah.
We're trust me, we're gonna hit some games this winter.
Oh yeah,
for sure. So that being said, should we flip over to our interview?
Absolutely.
Dude, everybody, seriously, enjoy this interview. It's nuts. It's everywhere. We're everywhere. But honestly, this man is, he's been everywhere. He's fought his way up. He was an amazing guest. He was very open to everything, anything that we asked him. He was funny. He was very informative. Just a fucking beaut. Like, right?
Dude, he was Johnny Cash of the OHL, for fuck's sakes.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Oh, that was the first time I swore.
Yeah, I'm not so good at that. So we're going to flip it over to him right now. Our boy, the Sheriff, Sean McMorrow. Enjoy.
Total beaut.
Roll it.
Don't talk.
Ladies man.
And gentlemen, this next guy on here with us is as tough as they come. He's played OHL, AHL, NHL, Quebec League. He's played overseas. He was also drafted by the Sabres as well. He had one season where he had over 500 minutes in the box. He fought 62 times in the same season. Let's welcome to the show the Sheriff, Sean McMorrow. Sean, what's up, man?
Not too much, guys. I'm just excited to be here with you kind gentlemen. It's an honor for me to be on the show with you guys. So thank you so much for having me.
Dude, thank you so much for sitting down with us. When I seen like your brother-in-law, I believe, reached out to us, and I had heard of you, but I like wasn't sure like of everything about you. And I started like looking you up and info and everything. And I was just like, 2 minutes later, I sent him a text. I was like, tell him that we would love to talk to him.
Well, I appreciate that, man. My brother-in-law is doing a great job being part of the small elite team of the Sheriff podcast behind the scenes. And, you know, the great thing is you guys could probably tell by having your own show is when you do a show, a lot of stuff comes out of it. Like, you know, you make really good connections with people. You get to do things that not normally maybe you wouldn't have been able to do. And one of the things for me is I'm able to be really close with my brother-in-law because we're doing this together. Mm-hmm. Right. So I'm just blessed to be a part of this process, and I'm happy to be a guest on your guys' show instead awesome, of me man. Stressing out on my own show.
Awesome. And hey, the best part too is that man right there, Rob, is my brother-in-law. So
right on
together too.
Yeah. So you guys know exactly what I'm saying.
So same thing, man.
Yeah. You put up with your brother-in-law's bullshit. I put up with my brother-in-law's bullshit. I get it.
There you go, man. There you go. You guys are funny, man.
So you, did you grow up out west or were you just born out west?
So I was born in Vancouver on the west coast of Canada. And my family moved to Toronto when I was 6 years old. So okay. I had a short part of my upbringing in Van City, but the majority of my upbringing was in Scarborough, a suburb of Toronto.
Yeah. Beauty. And that's
beautiful area. Beautiful area.
And that's probably obviously where you played a lot of your friggin' like hockey growing up, this and that, travel, obviously, right?
Yeah, like luckily for me, guys, like I played for a AAA team that had this incredible coach that wanted to have a team that did the most tournaments and like just kind of had the most fun. It was the Don Mills Flyers AAA team, which is one of the, you know, dominant Toronto AAA teams. And I was fortunate enough to make the team from novice. And I played on this team every single year from 9 years old to 15, except for 1 year I played for Wexford Raiders. So, yeah, man, it was pretty consistent for me. Strong group of parents. As you guys know, being hockey guys, like when you play minor hockey, like usually there's another set or two of parents that help with the driving and all that type of stuff. And, you know, you create lifelong friendships through that as well. Right, guys. So I was fortunate enough to just be in a really good situation with minor hockey in Toronto.
Awesome.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hockey's one great big family, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, man, it really is. And like, I mean, my family plays like every sport. Like I have a younger brother that is a professional basketball player. I was just talking to him before the show. He's 8 inches taller than me, right, guys? He's a legit 7-footer. And the man, you know, he's played like the better part of 10 years professionally in basketball. And, you know, basketball has like a camaraderie as well. But hockey just seems, because of the emotion, because of the fact that, you know, hockey is only one of two sports in the world, guys, that allows, you know, to somewhat degree police our own game. I mean, a lot less now than 15, 20 years ago. But it's a very unique sport. And I think because it's so fast and so emotional and so passionate that it's just a bigger team sport than the other ones.
Yeah, 100% there. Hey, did you ever play any like high school hockey or anything before you went like junior? Where did you play at?
Oh yeah. So I went to my local high school in grade 9, which was Pope John Paul II, which is in Scarborough, Military Trail in Morningside. It's my local high school, man. It's got every walk of life going through that building, man. Like, that's the unique thing about Toronto, is it's a melting pot, and you got rich areas beside middle class areas, beside really poor areas, beside kind of poor areas. Like, you know what I mean? You got everybody. So my local high school was a great experience because, again, like, you're walking the hallways of every walk of life, and that's how the world's going to be once you get out of high school. So that's the type of high school that you want to be in. But anyway, I know I'm blabbering on, but to get to the point, in grade 9, I played for the high school team in Pope. And the reason why it was so important to me was I just played so well for the team that I actually won the MVP, right? And I was in grade 9. And so this was the team that, you know, obviously, you know, for grade 12s, pretty much it should be all of, right? Yeah. And here I am, a niner, and, you know, playing for the Don Mills Flyers. And, you know, just proud to put on the Pope John Paul uniform. And I don't even remember how well we did. I know we didn't win the championship or anything, but I think we were a good team, you know, probably had a winning record, but didn't win any titles. Yeah. And I won the MVP at the awards ceremony at the end of the school year. And I'll never forget that, because I worked really hard for that. And I was very proud of it. And whenever you get an award, it's not really about the award, but the award represents how much passion and time went into whatever it is you won the award for. Mm-hmm. So it reminds you, it's like reading a detailed book. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It just reminds you. When you first asked me that, I had a smile on my face right away, because that Pope team, man. That was the only high school team I was on, because, well, I shouldn't say that, because in grade 10, I actually got accepted to St. Michael's College School in Toronto. And the cool thing about that was it was the first year that the St. Michael's majors were the OHL team in the Ontario Hockey League. Like, for the Toronto team was St. Mike's, right? So it was a very unique situation, but I got to see it firsthand in the hallways. Nice. Right? So
it's awesome, man.
I played for that school as well. So Pope and St. Mike's.
Yeah. Just so you know, Rob too's won. Tell him about your award, Rob.
Oh, I won SO Most Improved Player 3 times in a year in House League.
Hey, man. Hey, listen, man.
I put the work in.
Rob.
Now, I know you're joking.
John, but if we can rewind for a couple seconds here.
Okay.
How did you get started in hockey? You know, being in the Toronto area, but you have a strong basketball area. You have a strong hockey area, baseball, like all that. What brought you to hockey?
Well, to be honest with you guys, I was brought into hockey from Sheila McMorrow, my mother. Now, at that time, I was 5 turning 6, because I have a January birthday. So my birthday is always halfway through the hockey season, right? Mm-hmm. And so I definitely wasn't really old enough to be like, yeah, I'm going to enroll in hockey, right? Like, it's all at that age, it's everything our parents want us to do is what we do. But my mom registered me for house leagues in Scarborough, Malvern. And that was when I first started playing, buddy. I was skating with one foot. I was pushing off one foot, and then that's how it all started, buddy.
Mm-hmm. And I still do it. I still do it.
Yeah. That's fun. Me too sometimes, man. But that'll be after the times that I get my bell rung in a fight. You know, I'll forget how to skate sometimes, right?
Okay. Hey, so my second question is, so you said you played for that team from when you were 9 till you were 15.
Yeah. Don Mills Flyers. Yeah.
What brought you away from that team? Like what got you away from that team that you played for so long for that you end up going and playing for the next team?
Well, pretty much how it works with the minor hockey system in Toronto is if you're a kid that's at the highest level, which would be playing AAA, like the Don Mills Flyers for me, that would go from 9 years old till you're 15 to when you were the Bantam age. Now, right. You could continue playing at that level. You know, there'd be minor midget. And I think it's even added another year as well, like since I've left that, because I'm really old now, guys, right? But pretty much the next step.
That's cute.
The next step for me was to play Tier 2 Junior A the season before my OHL year, because if you went that route, then that was like, you know, the kind of the fast track route that players were doing that were expected to go to the OHL. So The triple A level with Don Mills was as far as 15 at Bantam. And then the expectations for someone that expected to go to the OHL, you got to be a 16-year-old rookie in the junior A provincial tier two level in Ontario if you plan on being a high pick in the OHL. And that's what I did. And it really worked out well for me because that was a part of my career that was right on point. Like I was like anybody that played in the NHL, their route was the route that I was taking at this point. So it was really good what I was doing. And you know, I attest to my family, the support, my mom, like, I look back now, guys, of like, you know, the team that I was in, you know, I mentioned all the tournaments and stuff. Like, I don't even know how my mom was able to do it. I could only imagine how she was able to wing it all, because there not only was me, but there was Patrick McMorrow, 3 years younger than me, that was also a AAA hockey player for the North York Canadiens. And then there was this huge avatar 7-foot brother that I have now, Liam McMorrow, who was the baby, and he played for Don Mills too.
Yeah.
Right. So there was three of us. That's awesome, man, playing triple A. And my mom wasn't remarried yet. So it was still a single parent family.
That's crazy,
right. So, and my sister played too, but I'm just talking about the triple A. Right. Yeah. So, man, I don't know how she did it, man. But like she did it. And I'm thankful. And as a result, we were all able to play really competitive hockey in a team sport, which made our childhoods so much better.
Mm-hmm.
That's fantastic. Here's the hockey moms.
Yeah, right? I was just going to say. I was just going to say, and that's why hockey moms are the best.
That's it, guys. That's it.
That's awesome. Really, that answered really my question perfectly. So you had your career mapped out, and you went the route that you were supposed to go.
Yeah, from that point, for sure. Yeah.
That's crazy, man. You also, when you
That's
went
awesome. That you knew that young that this is what I'm going to do.
Well, I mean, like the thing, this is the thing, like, and it's interesting that we're talking about it like this, because it's a great talking point. And the system of hockey, right? Like what I'm talking about right now, like a kid, like name any kid. Let's give a good example, a really high draft pick, Jason Spezza. Mm-hmm. He was a guy that I played with, was only 1 year younger than me. Let's use him as an example. Jason Spezza knew that he was going to play a long time in the NHL. He was a phenom when he was a kid, right? So he played AAA till the age I'm talking about. But the only difference is instead of going to tier two, Jason Spezza was a 15-year-old double underager playing in the OHL, right? So he was even one step fast-tracked more than the regular NHLer, right? So, but the system of hockey is almost like automatic, is what I'm trying to say. Like, if you're expected to go to the OHL, like I said, you're playing that tier two junior A year as a 16-year-old. But if you're going to go the Division I scholarship route, you know what I mean? You're playing in that league for a solid 2, 3, 4 seasons until your grades are good enough to be able to get that scholarship, right? So it's interesting how it all works out. It's not really the player, like in this case, me, knowing exactly the moves I have to do. It's just this system overhaul that guys just naturally go towards, that guys have done like before them that have been successful going to each route. So yeah, man, it's I can't even really explain how it works, but it just works like that. The system is deep in hockey and the culture is real.
Mm-hmm. I think you did explain it.
Yeah. Hey, so
it was awesome. It was
now
awesome.
I know why. Now I know why you're on this show, my man. I know why you're on this show, man. You make things loose and happy and really good energy, brother. You're bringing here, man.
I love doing this. I love meeting new people. I love even having just the hometown guys on here. It's so much fun. I enjoy every minute of it. And a good friend of ours that follows the show said to me, what would you rather have? Would you rather have an autograph from one of these guys or would you rather have a story? And 100% I'd rather have a story, you know, and that's what makes it so great. Mm-hmm.
I feel the same way, but I got to add to what you just said a little bit, my man. You're saying, oh, it's cool to have these, you know, hometown guys, man. I looked up your guys' show before I came on. You guys have had some huge guests, man.
Yeah.
Really big, man. What do you mean? Oh, little local hometown guys. Buddy, you guys are blockbuster, man. You guys got to be proud, man.
We're doing
guys,
okay.
65? Well, how many episodes are you guys in now?
55.
Yeah, 55.
Yeah. Okay, so, man, you guys are doing really good, man. You guys have a lot to be proud of.
Thank
and
you,
that's man. Why that's why I'm proud to be on here, man, is because I looked it up. I'm like, man, this ain't no joke, man. I better be on my most entertaining behavior.
The sheriff bringing the A game.
Yeah, he's bringing it.
This is a privilege.
Thank hey, you, man. So I also noticed when you went into the O, you were everywhere in the O. Like you played for a lot of teams. Like how did all that work out?
Man, it was. It's funny because, like, you know, like with your buddies and stuff, like, you know, you chirp each other and, you know, you got the friendly banter and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And like, so like my buddies, like, yeah, like, man, you look at that, like I played for six teams, man. Right. That's a lot. Right. But I'll tell you how it happened though. And I mean, half of them was just in one season being involved with that Mississauga Ice Dogs team with Jason Spezza. Uh-huh. Man, Don Cherry, man, it was one of the best experiences being a part of that team. The only problem is that the year that I was there was just one of the worst years that they had, right? But it was still the same people a couple years later when they started being respectable, right? Mm-hmm. But just the year I was there, you know, I was there. My buddy Dan Sullivan was there. Brian McGrattan, the Big Earn, he was there that year. Yeah. Chad Wiseman, you know, obviously Spez. You know, we had a guy, Omar and a fatty that was just like a phenom. I don't even know what happened to that guy, you know, but like, yeah, I mean, we had, Michael Moll in net, you know, he won that, that reality show of getting the invite to the NHL camp it was a reality show they had in Canada.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. Michael Moll won it, man. And he he played with me on that Mississauga team too. So, I mean, it was a great experience. Rick Vive, famous 50 goal scorer. Rick Vive was our coach, but we were a young team. We just couldn't win. We had a bunch of big names, but it just wasn't working out. And then Spezza demanded the trade because he needed to be on a team that was good because he was rated to go in the top two. It was either him or Kovalchuk, man, or Kovalchuk. Right.
Yeah.
So if he can't be on a last place team in the OHL and expected to go first, so he gets traded to Windsor. Windsor gives five players back for Spezza. Obviously, rosters need to be, like, there has to be room made. Yeah. So, like, a third of the team was traded because Spezza trade, right? So the thing is, though, is because this fire sale was going on, there was a lot of teams that were throwing out offers. I was supposed to go to the London Knights right off the hop, but Mississauga wanted more, so they traded me to Kingston. So I get to Kingston, I play seven games, I'm there for about 3 weeks, and then London just gets me from Kingston because they were trying to get me from Mississauga. And it was the Hunter brothers, Dale and Mark Hunter, they had bought the London Knights. I was with Mark in Sarnia, he drafted me. So it was like my original draft guy getting me back on a new team that he bought, me being involved with the Mississauga Ice Dogs the year that Spezza and the big fire sale. So like, it was just like there was legit reasons for it, But it was just really unlucky, man, that I kept getting in situations where I was getting traded, because I had some great billets. Every place that I was at, all those teams, I had a great experience there. Like I said, great billets, still keep in contact with all of them. And yeah, it was blessed to like know what it was like. Cause like as a player, you always wonder, like, I wonder what it's like to play for this team. I wonder if they play for that team. Like, you know what I mean? Like that, like that's just, it's very common. Like players that are listening to the show, they'll be like, yeah, he's right.
Yeah.
Right. You know what I mean? I got to experience six teams, man. So, I mean, I got to look at it some kind of positive light, right?
Yeah.
Like I know about six teams in the OHL. Like not too many guys can say that, yeah. Right? Might be a record. I mean,
John, you're a hot commodity.
Yeah. You're a popular guy.
Popular guy for good and popular guy for bad. Half the teams, you know what I mean? But like I said, you know, Brian McGrattan, he actually has me beat. He played for more teams than I did. And that's a big deal. But, but yeah, OHL was a great experience for me overall. It's a time of your life where you're learning to be a man, and some of us grow up a little bit quicker than others. You know, me physically, I grew up very fast. Mentally, I didn't, you know what I mean? So I was very immature 19-year-old playing for the Oshawa Generals, thinking that I was Muhammad Ali, you know, doing chants in the arena, going, you know, with my hockey stick, boom, 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 the champ is here. Like I had tons of confidence at that age.
Yeah.
And a lot of it was to that Ali movie, man, that where Will Smith is Muhammad Ali. And yeah. So yeah, that just reminded
me. I thought it was going to be, I am the greatest.
Yeah. I mean, his cameo is unreal, man. Like I use a lot of his character stuff throughout my life.
Hey, how was it coming in the Windsor as a visitor in the O? Cause we talked to guys and they hated coming to Windsor.
Oh man, you're right. That's a great question. Windsor was the one arena that I actually remember in pure detail. Like they would have a group that was definitely handpicked to be behind the visitors bench. And the thing with me is, because the unfortunate thing with me in the OHL was I had a reputation of being very tough. And then by my last year, they were giving me like, yeah, he's the toughest guy in the OHL, like, you know, but like by my 19-year-old season, right? So that's cool, especially if that's what you need to do to get to the next level, like I did, right? So yeah. I was able to use that reputation, you know, to help with the Sabres signing me to an entry-level contract. And like, so that helped me. But the pressure that I was under because of that title was very hard as a teenager, right? And going into Windsor, man, they really, really, really tested your mental toughness, man.
Yeah.
Because there was some games where it would be a one goal game, dude. The fourth lines aren't getting out there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm on the fourth line. So they got all of the second period and all of the third period to absolutely rip apart all the guys on the fourth line that aren't seeing the ice.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, McMorrow. Are you going to get out there anytime soon, bud? McMorrow, I have a pillow over here if you need something, you know, to support your butt. I know you've been on that wooden bench for a while. Like, trust me, man. I could say 40, 50 more lines, man, just from the Windsor fans. Like it was unbelievable. Like as a player, you respect the fact that people are using sports to entertain and actually amuse themselves. And even if it's at your expense, you can't hate on it, man. You can't hate on it if you're a fan. And I'm a big fan. I'm not just a player, guys. I'm a big fan of hockey, man. And I'm a stat guy too. So like we could go back and forth on stats, man. I'm as big as a fan as you guys, man.
That's just funny though.
I just started watching hockey when we started the podcast, so yeah, the funny thing is, go ahead.
Oh, I was gonna say the size of character that you have, buddy. It wouldn't matter what sport you were talking about, bro. It'd be the same result. You're bringing entertainment. Yeah. You're making people smile and laugh, and that's what it's all about, my man. Yeah.
Buddy, when we end up meeting up, I'll show you a couple toe drags that you could have used in NHL.
Hey, man. Hey, man. You guys will be surprised, man. There was times in my career where there was some interesting stuff that happened. And I'll give you guys an example. Okay. You're talking about toe drags, right, man? Okay, so check this out. I played the preseason in the NHL where they were introducing the shootout, right? So this was after the lockout season. When they changed all the rules, were pretty much, you know, starting the grandfathering session of getting all the tough guys out of the league, and you know, and so they were implementing the rule of if an NHL game is tied, then it's going to be a shootout now. You know what I mean? So they wanted to introduce the shootout to the fans. So that preseason, the first year that they had it, no matter what the score was of that preseason game in the NHL, they would have a shootout, just three shooters aside. So now I'm blessed with being able to play in my hometown of Toronto. I'm playing for Buffalo Sabres against the Toronto Maple Leafs in Toronto, Air Canada Center, Toronto, Canada, where I'm from, okay? Mm. So I'm playing this NHL preseason game, which is like a dream come true. It's the same deal as a regular season game. It's just preseason. Yeah. Same deal, man. Same NHL players. You just got a few AHL guys mixed in there. But usually by the halfway point of preseason, there's hardly any AHL guys left. It's like guys that go on waivers and, you know, and then they end up going to Europe and stuff. Like, trust me, like, you know, they get the real deal. And so it was a dream come true. I played 5-6 preseason games that season. And I was like on cloud 9 for like 8 weeks, man, in September and October of that year, because I was playing a shortened NHL season, the preseason. Like it was unreal for a hockey guy like me to be able to do that, man. So, I'm so excited about that. I got off track here. So, okay, introducing the shootout. So now Lindy Ruff, he's the coach of Buffalo at the time. So Lindy Ruff is like calling out the shooters. So he has to call out three guys so the guys know who's going. So he's like, a Finneganoff, Drury, McMorrow. Right. So I'm like, what? Like, he's picking me as a shooter. Right. So, so I was the third shooter. I'm going down. You know who the goalie was for Toronto? Ed Belfour, man. Eddie the Eagle, man. Yeah, bro. I grew up watching Eddie the Eagle on Chicago, like as far back as the Blackhawks, man. Yeah. Right. And so, man, I'm thinking to myself, just don't fall. Don't, you know, just don't, like,
get a shot,
dude,
off.
What do you mean? There's 18,000
people. Fucking toe, like, pick.
Come on, man. It's my hometown. Like, bro, that's what I'm thinking about. I'm not even worried about if I score or not. I don't even care. Yeah. I'm just worried about getting down to the net. Right. So I get down there. You know, you have to, like, you know, you have to do something. Right. So I make a little move, drop a shoulder, and I decide, because I had a pretty decent shot. You know what I mean? Even for like a fighter, tough guy, whatever, enforcer, I had a hard shot. Guys would compliment me. So I'm like, dude, I definitely have to shoot. That's my only chance of scoring. I'm not going to deke out Ed Belfour, right? So I get to the top of the circle and I just let it rip, man. And you know what happened? Bing! Right off the crossbar, man. Like, I beat Ed Belfour, but it bing right off the crossbar. Right. Yeah, man. So, and then that's a good showing, right? Like, someone dings one off the crossbar, you know, he had the goalie beat. Like, you'd be like, yeah, man, good job, man. You know, you had him beat, you know, it just didn't go in, whatever, you know, like, so I was happy with it, man. Mm-hmm. But man, oh, was I ever nervous, man? Yeah. I couldn't believe Lindy Ruff, but obviously he did it because it was my hometown. And, you know, I'd be able to tell, you know, the story 20 years later on an amazing podcast. And, you know,
that's awesome of freaking him to actually like think of that at that time. Like, it's his hometown. They're like, here, go. It's only exhibition, so who cares, right?
Exactly. Yeah, man. No, it was totally super cool, man. If I ever run into him, I'll thank him.
That's awesome, dude.
That is a cool moment in your life. You know what I mean? That you, everybody, and you know it's preseason still, and everybody's watching still. Like, it's hockey night in Canada. You know,
yeah,
what I mean?
Man. Yeah, 100%. People are watching. Mm-hmm. People, and the thing
you
is,
got a billion eyes on you.
A billion and one.
Yeah, I still would have toe dragged him.
If I could, I would, man. Trust me.
But you know, Sean, like you were saying, you know how when you started skating, you started out with one leg and push off, right? You know, yep. So I used to do the same thing. So my right leg got so big that I could only turn right, toe drag with my right foot. My other leg, I just walk in circles all the time everywhere I go. That's all I do, bro.
Right on, man.
Dude,
I hear you though.
I noticed too when you started like in like AHL stuff like that, you racked up some serious penalty minutes, man. Some serious, like one season you had like 34 games and you had like 180 something minutes or 190 something minutes. So like, you fought everybody. Is there any, like, who was that one guy who you fought that, like, who gave you the best go? Not necessarily saying whooped your ass or this or that. Who gave you the best fight you've ever had?
Well, I mean, it's easier to figure it out now because I'm able to talk about it with the platforms that, you know, that what we both have of us having our own shows, right? So, like, yeah. I've had some of my biggest rivals as my guests. Right, guys like Alex Penner, Weapon X, guys like Brandon Sugar Sugden, you know, like Sugden, he was my main rival for three straight seasons. My second, third, and fourth year pro, when I played in Rochester and Syracuse, probably the biggest rivalry in the AHL, at least in the East Division. Mm-hmm. And man, Sugden, best technical fighter in my opinion ever. Right, and he was a guy that I was just like, man, like you just can't take a night off, like against a guy like that. Like, it's just, it's all out, man. You have to be on point on every single level when you fight a guy like Sugar. And man, it was hard because we seemed like we were playing them every other game. Cause you play more teams, the teams that are closest to you in the AHL, you play the most, like it's not really even how they do it. And that's just, you know, for teams to save money and stuff like that. So it's understandable. Yeah, yeah. But, man, if that team that you play a lot has a guy like Sugden as the tough guy, man, it's a hard task. But part of it, that's part of it. Like, I love the battle of the combat too. So it was an honor to have a guy that was so skilled as a fighter, as Sugden, to have to fight all the time. It obviously made me a better fighter because, you know, you obviously – you know, the level that you're, you know, playing with or against, you know, it like improves your level, right? If it's higher than yours at the time. And, you know, Sugden's 4 years older than me. You know, at that point of our careers, he was definitely a better overall fighter, and he made me a better overall fighter as being a younger guy. So that was an extended answer to the question.
That was a perfect answer though.
But yeah, man, Brandon Sugar Sugden, he was the guy that knocked me the most for 3 years in a row. Jesus.
Tough way yeah, to make a living, man.
Like, yeah. Every time he moves the camera, I think I'm on an episode of Cribs or something.
Like, yeah. I just like, as I was mentioning before, like us having these shows, like gives us opportunities to do things that normally we wouldn't have done. And, you know, another one is, you know, I do my show from my mother's house in Scarborough, right? So that gives me an opportunity to, you know, have dinner with them, see my mom. You know, she's kind of a part of the show because a lot of everyone that are guests on my show have a part of my career. Like, they're a part of my story, right? So my mom was in that story the whole time. And, you know, our parents are our biggest supporters. In my case, my mom, 100% biggest supporter of mine. Wouldn't have been able to do anything without her, man, and all the highs, all the lows. And yeah, man, it was, so I get to see her 2-3 times a week more than I did before. Cause that's how busy we are with our show. So
that's awesome,
it's definitely a blessing.
Beauty. That's great. That is awesome. And you know what, like I said before, here's the moms for all the shit they put up with us and all the nasty stuff they have to deal, especially like, you know, you're washing your dirty underwear and stuff like that. You know? Like, come on.
So
they don't deserve that.
I got a question. Now, I'm not saying like anything bad or negative or anything, but the upside down Toronto Maple Leaf sign that I keep seeing in Rob's background.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. What's the story behind that? I'm just curious. Like I keep looking at it.
So you know about the flags. If your flag is upside down, that's a country in distraught. Like there's
something
fucked out there. Yeah, man. Something's going on.
Something's okay, bad. Okay. Yeah. No, I hear you, man. I hear you.
That's where I'm at.
I hear you, man. And you know what? I'm a big Leaf fan too, man. Right? I'm a Toronto boy.
I got the winning 67 team here. You know, that was the last time we won. I wasn't even alive yet. I'm 52 years old. This is where I'm at.
Yeah, man. Well, okay. Let me add to this a little bit. So first off, I want to talk about Game 7, Toronto against Montreal. Now, Toronto's up 3-1 in the series. It's such a disappointment that it's come to a Game 7, right? Mm-hmm. And then I think, like, most of us, like, I'm saying us, I'm assuming that you guys like the Leafs, you know, we're just like, okay, like, yeah, they're going to definitely win tonight. Like, you know, but we also said that in Game 6. We also said that in Game 5, right? Mm-hmm. So now we're just like, yeah, no, for sure. For sure they got it, man. Matthews, Marner, Clemens, they got it. Man, let me tell you something, man. I have had summer shinny,
mm-hmm.
like matches that were more intense than that Game 7 that Toronto played. Like, that was completely unacceptable, in my opinion. I was so disappointed. I couldn't believe it. And, like, they brought in guys like Wayne, you know, Smoking Joe, and they did a good job making the team tougher and having more character, but they weren't getting the ice time in the playoffs. So it didn't even matter anyway,
mm-hmm.
about those guys that they added.
Yeah.
The Leafs core were way too soft, man. I hope they all had personal trainers that made them box or they did something to toughen them up, because the stick checking and all this just crap that mm-hmm. Toronto elite players we're doing in the playoffs and got them eliminated early, man. Like they got to bounce back and do something this year, because you know, it looks like a lot of them are coming back and you know, like they should have won. They could have won, man. Montreal made it to the finals, man. Mm-hmm. Montreal almost won.
What do you think about Toronto letting Hyman go?
That's another big disappointment. I mean, that was a guy that was.
Oh,
it was really like a really important part of the team, and they just let him go, man. Like,
yeah, you know, when Kyle Dubas talked about core, I considered Zach Hyman core.
He
was part of that core. Now, here's an interesting stat that nobody has won a Stanley Cup with a $10 million player on it. And guess what? Toronto's got four.
No, I heard that stat. That's very interesting. It's very interesting. But, like, I mean, players weren't making $10 million for a long time either, right? So it's kind of a mixed stat. It's a short time stat that's based on a shorter time, right? So maybe, like, you never know. Like, in the next couple of years, like, there could be back-to-back. Right. And then if it was only based on 5 or 6 years, then it wouldn't be too bad. So I don't really look that much into that stat, especially because Carey Price almost proved it wrong this year as well. Right.
Mm-hmm.
But man, speaking of Carey Price, like I know we're jumping all over the place, gentlemen, but those are what
it's all good.
That's what the best podcasts are, though, my man. No one really knows. It's always the unknown, man. It's just what happens at the time. Right. But man, what about Seattle not picking Price?
I know.
Like, man, wouldn't you just go all in on that? It's a generational goal. 100%. Who cares about the cap with that kind of stuff? Right.
Yeah, I agree. But I agree. You could have put him on a shelf for a while and let him get all nice and healthy.
Brought him
back in the playoffs, and it doesn't even cost us a salary cap hit.
Yeah, but his thing though, he's doing
big
bonuses though, like huge bonuses. I think that's another thing that
he's also made like a bazillion dollars. Like seriously. off his jerseys alone, think about it. Everybody in Montreal loves Carey Price, except when he lets a goal in.
Yeah, no, he's definitely the king of that city. I had the chance to live in that city for a few years, and man, the Montreal Canadiens are literally like I know, like you hear like people say, oh, like, you know, the players are treated like gods, but I'm telling you guys, man, they really are treated like gods. Yeah. They really are, man. Any restaurant, any place, anywhere, there's no hesitation. They're so recognizable within that Île de Montréal, within that island, man. They're so recognizable that they can do whatever they want, but there's pros and cons to that as well, as we all know.
Sean, if you don't mind, like in 2012 to 2014, you were out of the game for a little bit because actually you were in jail. So one of the things I kind of wanted to know, if you don't mind just kind of letting us, like, it doesn't have to be in full detail, whatever you want, but let's kind of like fill us in as to what happened. And also how hard was it to come back being out of the game for that long?
Yeah. Well, I mean, up until probably this year, I hadn't really talked about that a lot. Right. Mm-hmm. And the reason being, guys, is like, I mean, anybody that kind of, you know, has the experience of having to do some jail time, I mean, like the natural thing is, you know, to try to put it behind you and, you know, and move on and so far and keep it positive. And yes, that's all true. Right. But for those of us like myself that want to be public people, for those of us, sorry about that, guys, for those of us that want to be in the public eye, they have to make it a part of their story, which I've accepted and I've completely embraced. Mm-hmm. Now, the unfortunate thing is that, so that's one part of it, right, guys? So like, that's one part of it. But like, the other part of it is, it's just a wild story, period.
Yeah.
And like, me being like, a pretty open guy, like, I mean, when I hear things, if I hear like a crazy story, like nothing would really truly surprises me like anymore. Like, you know, people talk about, you know, like crazy stories, like even stuff about aliens or like whatever, like, like you have to keep an open mind now. You can't just be like, oh no, this is how it is. Like no one really knows how it is, man. We all learn from our experiences, and what doesn't kill us makes us stronger. Right. Man, I'm going to give you guys the shorter version, but I have no problem because it's important for me to talk about it and let people know what happened, because like I said, I need to own this and let it be a part of my story. If I plan on being a sports broadcaster, if I plan on being a big personality on television, which that's what I want to do, guys. Right. Mm-hmm. So I need to talk about this and let people know what happened, because I'll tell you what, there's more than one article online that's really shitty article, dude, for Sean McMorrow. It's really shitty. And the reason why it's shitty is because I signed a plea agreement in that case. Right. I was convinced by my very high-priced attorney that I should plead guilty because the case was bogus. It was a publicity stunt by the U.S. Attorney's Office. There wasn't any physical evidence against me. What it was it was a conspiracy marijuana charge, right?
Oh, okay.
And so it was two of my friends I thought were my friends. They were guys that I used to go to after games to buy my pot, my weed, right? Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, it's funny now, like, because it's like legal, like where we are, and,
yeah,
you know, and it's, but back then it wasn't. And back then this was, and this is also in the United States, which is, you know, like a lot different from Canada, right? Yeah. So this is when I was in Rochester, New York, and it was based on my second and third year. And so these were guys, they were buddies of mine. I could go over there. I could smoke my joints. I could feel comfortable. As an athlete, you always kind of feel that you're being protected because there's a lot of people that you know they're giving you attention because you're on the team. You know that if you weren't on that team, they probably wouldn't care anything about what you had to say or do or anything. But because you're on this team that's put on this platform, then all of a sudden you're important, right?
Yeah.
So you feel this as an athlete. But what comes with it is you feel like let's say people came in, like you're in a bar and people came in to rob the bar. Yeah. You feel as an athlete that these people that are making a big deal about you, that they're going to protect you. They're going to be like, hey, McMorrow, come on, come with me. Get out of here. Let's, you know what I mean? Like you feel that you're protected. So as a 21, 22-year-old guy, these guys were about 10 years older than me, right? And I was like, man, you know, this is so cool. These guys, man, they're so nice to me. I'm able to feel like I'm protected. I'm able to smoke my joints because I like to smoke marijuana, yeah, but it's not really accepted in all circles, especially at this time. So it kind of had to be kind of like a secret, right? So yeah, that's what I did, man. And this is where I was involved, and this is where I have to own it. So it came to a point where my buddy was kind of like Sean, like, would you be in a situation where you'd be able to kind of like lend me like $2,500? And if you're able to do that on a Friday, then by Monday, I could give you $5,000 because you did that. Mm-hmm. Right. And I was like, okay, this is my buddy. I obviously know he's doing something with it, but yeah, I just don't care, man. Like, it's not, I'm not being told, you know, people are being hurt and stuff if you do this, like, you know, nothing, yeah, like that, right? So just like, you know, we're kids, man. It's university age. Rochester was a huge university town, so it was like I was in university, you know what I mean? And let's say I was like a fraternity boy and had a big allowance, came from a wealthy family, like, trust me, these guys are gambling and stuff in these universities, doing all this crazy stuff, you know. I was giving my buddy, you know, money, man, so he could re-up on his marijuana, man. You know what, yeah, I mean? Like, that's what I did, man. You know what I mean? And so I did it probably about 10 or 12 times, mm-hmm, right? And so 2 years later, like, so, and then the other thing with athletes is we play in these cities. I was blessed with being able to play in a city for 4 straight years. It's very, yeah, uncommon for someone to be able to do that if they're not in the NHL, right? Because, yeah, you're bouncing around if you're in the AHL on the coast. Like, you're doing what you can to make the big club, the big league. So, mm-hmm, you know, you don't stay in one spot for a long time, but I was able to do that. I had like a career there. I knew a lot of people, you know, won multiple awards. Like, it was great. Like, I had a great life experience in Rochester, New York. But the bad experience is what came out of this case. And that was the only bad experience that I ever had. And the case was really like, so 2 years later, these same two guys, I hadn't talked to them in a couple of years because I had moved on. I was, you know, living in a different part of the country, playing for a different team. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of, you kind of lose contact with some people, and, you know, and these guys were in that group. So they're in a lot of shit. They get pulled over. They're in a car where they have like a weapon. There's like a firearm. There's marijuana, there's a bunch of money, I don't know, maybe a little bit of coke, or, you know, this is a really bad situation. They're in like a stolen rental car and they're across state lines, which is a really big deal in the States.
Yeah.
It's like a lot worse if you go across the state line with whatever, yeah, you're doing. And you know what I mean? So they had all this stuff against them. So there's like 3 or 4 of them in the car. 2 of the guys were my buddies that, you know, that I was explaining, you know, what I would do. Could you guys still see me properly? The screen has changed for me. Okay, cool. So they're in shit. They get pulled over. Everyone's arrested. They're in holding cells. And, you know, and then so my one buddy, after a couple hours, says, okay, I'm ready to talk now, right? They all weren't saying anything when they got arrested or whatever. And so my one buddy's like, okay, I'm willing to talk. So he comes up with this idea where he's like, you know what, like, you know, that stuff we used to do with Sean, like, he used to give us that money. Like maybe I can just say like that, you know, he was part of like our operation. And then maybe if I do that, you know, I can get myself out of trouble with this situation. And, you know, so he's probably thinking all this stuff. And the reason why I'm saying all this stuff, because I was able to see all the disclosure. I was able to read like how this all came about. Mm-hmm. So my one buddy goes out and he's like, I'm ready to talk. And he's like, so I'm willing to talk about an operation that was marijuana coming in from Canada to the US, where an NHL hockey player was the kingpin. He was the leader of the operation. And I'm willing to talk about it if you guys can, you know, help me with this situation. I know I'm in a lot of shit here. Like, you know what I mean? So the cops are hearing this and they're like, all right, well, you know, we'll call, you know, the local FBI office, see if that is any of interest to them. And, you know, if it is, then yeah, maybe you can help yourself out with this. So they put a call into the FBI office. FBI office is like, yeah, we're on it. Uh-huh. Tell him we'll give him a deal. We want to talk to him, right? NHL hockey player, black NHL hockey player, woo-hoo-hoo-hoo, right? And like, obviously I'm being sarcastic, but that's just the world we live in, gentlemen. And I'll tell you, man, I'll tell you what, man, it was like a Hollywood movie, man. Every single member of that U.S. attorney's office, like that was part of like the prosecution team, they all got promotions. Okay. My lawyer got paid, man. He secured the bag, right? Because not only was he had a $50,000 retainer, but he also like finagled like money kind of towards the end where he was like, you know, I got to use like a private investigator for this, that, the other. And, you know, we have to do this because it's important for Sean. And you know what I mean? Like he's telling my family this. So like we had to cough up like another 10, 15 grand, like right before, like it was so bizarre. And my case was, so what they did was they charged me with, it was the minimal requirements for a federal indictment. That's the proper wording for it. So they charged me they made up the story of what they were going to come up with. And, but they knew that they didn't really have anything, but they're like, okay, we'll just charge them with the minimal requirements for the federal indictment. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, and I'm smiling when I'm saying this, is because it took a long time for me to get over all this. So when I explain it, it's just, it's funny because it is funny, man. It's just unfortunate that I'm talking about myself. Yeah. Like, and that's the crazy thing. So the second point is the U.S. has a rule with any drug case, but especially a conspiracy case, where there's a 5-year statute of limitations. So they have to charge you within 5 years of whenever you did your thing. Okay. So they said that the indictment came 4 years, 11 months, and 30 days from the last known conspiracy, right? So like that, I found that was pretty interesting as well, right?
Yeah.
And then again, in the US, people need to know that the reason why you hear the term, you know, a broken American justice system is mostly because of the new conspiracy charge that the US government came up with. And they came up with it because when the five families in New York were just doing their thing with organized crime, right? And then you got guys like John Gotti that are just laughing in front of the camera with his arm around his attorney saying, my attorney is the best attorney in the world. And I know you guys have seen this footage, right? So what it was this guy would go to court and the FBI would never be able to convict him because he was never close enough to any of the crimes. They knew he was doing it, but they just couldn't get him in court. So they came up with this new thing called the conspiracy charge. So what the conspiracy charge is instead of it being racketeering or intimidation or, you know, murder or whatever, it's conspiracy racketeering, conspiracy intimidation. So what it is they don't need any physical evidence to convict you, but what they do need is more than one person to testify that you were part of the conspiracy. Well, and that's all they need, man. And then once they have that, so they can get the two rats to do it for whatever reason they're doing it for. For my buddies, it was to get them out of a really bad stop that they were in. Okay. Yeah. All they need to do is, okay, so now, did I talk to my buddies on the phone? Yes. They got a lot of call records, like the phone records, times. Then they could like compare it to times where marijuana was delivered. And if I had called that day, and it's really weak, bizarre stuff, but it's good enough for a conspiracy charge. So what I was facing was two counts that were 5-year minimums. So if I took it to trial and I had lost, going to jail for 10 years,
yeah,
wasn't really willing to kind of take those risks. Like I'm a confident guy, man. Like I don't really want to take those risks. Right.
Yeah.
So my lawyer's like, look, you're not going to go to jail. You just got to plead guilty, dude. No one wants to go to trial. They all know this was a long time ago. They know all the things you've done since that, all these community awards, man of the years.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This was the case was 2003 to 2005. The court, like you mentioned, was 2012, right, guys? So, like, even if I was like, yeah, I did it, I did everything, it was 7 years after the fact. Like, you know what I mean? And we're talking marijuana here. Like,
yeah, that's not,
you know what I mean? It's very weak. And then so on sentencing day, like, I was in the frame of mind where, like you have to understand, like, I have a high-priced U.S. attorney saying, defense attorney saying, dude, you're not going to jail. So I'm going to believe the guy. I'm in his office. He's like, you're not going, you know, it's just not going to happen. So we're going to plead guilty. And even if the judge gives you 6 months, because you're an international, this, it's still considered probation and you still don't go to jail. So I'm thinking, like, even if the judge gives me a little bit of time, I still don't have to go. Right. Mm-hmm. I'm having guys, like, I have a lot of aunts and uncles that are really prominent people. Like, they did very well in their careers and in their lives. And, you know, so I got like my uncles coming up to me and they're like, you know, putting their arm around me being like, Sean, you know what? We're so glad this day has come. Like, this is finally going to be over. You know, like you've been through enough, because like I got indicted in 2012, mm-hmm. but it was 2 years. Like from the indictment to the sentencing, there was 2 years, like there was two seasons. Right. And so like it was a long time that I had to go through court and everything. And my so I had a big party planned in Toronto, like for that evening. I had 25 family members in the courtroom. I was engaged to a girl from Rochester, New York. Right. So all of her family's there. Oh, fuck. We're all planning to go back to Toronto. This is finally going to be over.
Yeah.
And now, so the prosecutor talks, then the defense, oh no, sorry. The defense talks first, prosecutor gets to go last. And then, you know, the defendant gets to speak on their behalf if they choose to. And, you know, you damn well, I chose to talk. You guys know I'm a talker. Mm-hmm. You guys haven't even been able to get a word in. I've been talking.
When did you start that?
I don't know, man. I didn't even know how to talk. I just started talking today. So yeah, man. So then the judge says his thing. And then, like, to be honest, guys, like, I didn't really think anything bad was going to happen until the part of the speech where the judge used the word liberty. Because he's like, I know it's been a long time since this happened, and you've done so many good things. Because I had so many character reference letters, every coach, every GM I've ever had, like, you know, Randy Cunningworth, the coach of the Rochester Americans, all the Buffalo Sabres brass, everybody was supporting me, man. I had a judge that was a Jesuit Christian. Jesuit Christians are supposed to be about redemption and second chances. And you know what I mean? And I've never got in trouble ever. You know what I mean? This was the only thing that I'm being accused of ever in my life, man. I've had a squeaky clean record, bro. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I was raised very well. Like, you know what I mean? Come from a very good family, right? Mm-hmm. And I had a lot of support, man. And that judge, he goes, yeah, long time ago, this, that, the other. But the only way that one could really learn from his mistakes is his liberty. Like, he said something like that. And I'm like, as soon as he said that, I'm like thinking, I'm like, this guy is going to send me to jail today. Like, is this guy going to do this? I'm like, no, he's not going to do it, is he? Right? And I'm listening to this, and it's like a dream. It's like a movie. And then how it ended was like a scary movie, because like the words that he said is he's like, I hereby sentence you to the Federal Bureau of Prisons for a term of 24 months, right? And then, so the first thing I thought when he said it is I'm like 24 months. I'm like, that's 2 years, yeah. Right? And like, it sounds stupid me saying that, yeah. but that's where I was at. I'm like, that's 2 years. And then I kind of like, I didn't like faint, but I kind of like almost like fell over. Like, I was just kind of like, what is going on here, man? We're just going to a party. We're supposed to leave. No, why am I going the other way? Like I couldn't believe it. And then the wildest thing about it, guys, is that like someone in my position that where they're a first time offender, they don't have any violence or weapons in their case. Like they can negotiate if they know they're going to be sentenced to a little bit of time. Like if they think they're going to get like 6 months or a year, like there's such a thing called as a self-surrender where you're like, if you know you're getting time, your lawyer can negotiate that if you're sentenced to time, that you don't have to go to jail right away. You're able to go back home, take care of your affairs. You're usually given about 30 days.
Yeah.
And then your family is able to drive you to the institution. So you're able to skip the part where you have to be classified and you're in like an institution with all these crazy people because they're classifying you. And then boom, okay, yeah, Sean gets to go to the minimal security camp because his case is a joke and there's no like violence or weapons. So yeah, I went to the lowest of the lowest of the lowest securities. They call it a camp. It was mostly guys that did like tax stuff or guys that did fraud and
yeah, no one, you know, really like violent or anything.
Conspiracy charges like myself, stuff like that. You know what I mean? And what did I do when I was there, guys? Like I made the best of the time. I never, we talked about all the OHL teams I played for. Like, so obviously every time I got traded, I had to switch high schools too. Right. So like, I never got my high school degree, like when I was 18 and I went on to play pro and I never finished. I was 2 credits short. And so, you know, you better bet on, I got my high school when I was at Moshannon Valley Correction Center. I ended up getting my GED.
Good for you, bro.
Then I ended up teaching the GED because you have to have a job there, right? So I ended up being a teacher and teaching the GED. Then I moved on and started teaching an exercise class. I took a lot of business courses. They said they were college level. I learned a lot of things, man. But one of the biggest things that I learned is I learned who I was, because through a class called Paradigm Thinking, which is a class that has a lot of cognitive ways of thinking and stuff like that, I was able to find what my true values were, what my life purpose was, and what the true meaning of success is, right? And a lot of people think that success is, you know, having a big car and a big fancy house and a nice car and, you know, like a hot wife and stuff like that. But what success really is, guys, is, you know, living in the here and now, being present and living out what your life purpose is. Okay. Mm-hmm. And if you're doing those three things, then that is what success is, because then you're going to be happy. And that's what I really learned when I was there. I really learned who Sean McMorrow was. I learned why I liked doing all the public appearances, why I liked going into the schools and hospitals and speaking to the big crowds and being in front of the camera like I am with you guys right now, is because that's what my passion is. I'm passionate about those things. And that's why I want to get into sports broadcasting and be a part of sports on the other level, because I'm passionate about it, guys. Yeah. That's why I love doing my show. That's why I love being on your show, yeah. Right? Because I love doing it, right? And that's, I really learned who I was. And when I got out of there, it took me a while to kind of like, you know, get back into society and stuff like that. But I was able to get right back into hockey. I was in phenomenal shape. Because I mean, I had to do 20 straight months, right, guys? And
yeah.
I didn't have one cigarette. I didn't have one sip of alcohol. You know what I mean? I didn't do any drugs. You know, I pretty much improved my body. It was in phenomenal shape. And then, you know, when you get back on the ice from playing 10 plus years pro already, I mean, you're so excited to get back out there. You're like a kid back in the playground, man. Like, so it was quite the experience, man. But doing those laps around the ice when I first got back out there, like, you know, like a lot of guys are embarrassed to show their emotions and stuff. But I'll tell you what, man, this guy right here, I'm one of the most emotional guys you'll ever meet, man. I the tears were flying around, bro, when I was doing those laps. Like I really felt back at home, like once I was able to get back on the ice. And then my team was so supportive in that Quebec League where I ended up, where I finished off my career. My team was so supportive that it was like I came back to my second family, like when I came back, you know what I mean? Yeah. And when I got out, it was like February, right? So it was kind of like towards the end of the regular season. And I remember they had me come up for a weekend, and I actually went up with Alex Penner, Weapon X, because he was playing for the team that year. And so they were flying him in every weekend, but that weekend we drove up so I could hang out with him. And, you know, got to watch the games and got to see, you know, like life really does have second chances. If you're willing to, you know, like own what you've done and learn from your mistakes. I mean, you're telling me that any company can't overlook, you know, going through an experience where you're able to improve your life and, you know, choose the route of being better instead of getting worse, like a lot of people do when they go through things like that, then I think there'd be something wrong with that company if they weren't able to overlook that, if you're willing to own everything that you've done and learn from your experiences. So, I mean, that's the gamble that I'm going to take, guys. I'm going the route of owning what I've done, telling my story, and, you know, having faith that people cannot look at me different because I've had that experience. And, you know, I'm judged on his experiences, man. So, you know, I think that I made the best of it. And I think that I may have improved myself because of it. So that is a lot of detail that I told you guys for a short story.
That is a fucking insane story though, dude. That's
nuts. Yeah, man. Yeah.
Holy fuck though.
And dude, I know that we have to talk about it, right? Yeah. I also know that I've killed your Zoom time.
Dude, don't worry about it. We were on unlimited. Rob, do you have anything else for him? Because we're going to have to do part freaking two with him.
Is that what we're going to do? I would love to
coming
do that.
Back on the show.
Dude, man.
Because we haven't even actually got into your NHL.
Yeah, we haven't even got really into the hockey. Man. We've been over an hour.
We haven't even got into really the like LNAH or anything, bro. I know. So let's do that, guys. Let's do a part two. I'm sorry for all the extra.
No, you're all good, man. This is why we got you on.
After school specials.
Yeah.
It was an awesome story. And I'm so happy that you got to get out what you needed to get out. Mm-hmm. And you know what? It would make a great movie. I'll tell you that now.
Well, I mean, there is something in the works right now. I through the podcast again, I was able to connect with a great gentleman named Ryan Phillips, who's out in Van City on the West Coast. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Ryan Phillips. He's actually, he has had a documentary on National Geographic, and, you know, the people that did the documentary, which is incredible. You guys should check it out. Just if you YouTube Ryan Phillips, National Geographic documentary. You know, it was a really good piece, and they're interested in my story, and, you know, we're trying to get something done there. But I mean, that's not really what it's all about, but I really want to get my story out there, because I do believe that it's a strong message and that people can really learn from my experiences and situations.
Crazy, man.
And don't trust anybody.
Yeah, I know. I know,
family, don't trust them.
Oh, Jesus, man.
That's not so.
Man, it was, I'm telling you, man, it took a long time to accept, man. Like, it took a while to, like, you know, but you know what? Like, it's like they said, things that don't kill you make you stronger, man. So exactly. you have to look at it like that, especially for those situations.
Rob,
part two, we'll just pick up right from here.
I was just going to say, do you have anything else?
Explode.
Yeah. Rob, do you have anything else for him that you want to ask him this time?
I loved every minute of it, though. I loved every minute. And I really appreciate
you. You're a character, buddy.
Coming on there, Sean. And I wish you the best success in your podcast. And hopefully you keep listening to us. But I didn't know about yours, and I will start listening to yours.
Yeah.
Please do, man. Please do. And you know what? We're going to have to do some cross promotion, man. I'd love to get you guys on our pod.
For sure. That'd be great.
Yeah,
you
Sean,
do something like that.
I just want to say thank you, man. I wish your pod all the best. I'm definitely going to be locked in on it now. We're definitely going to have to do that.
Awesome, and, buddy. Yeah. So
part
so,
two's
so
a must.
Danny, yeah. So yeah, part two is definitely a must. So Danny, right. You know, obviously he's my brother-in-law, but he's also like the main business guy too. So, okay. So like he probably like, obviously I do the shows, but I'm working full time. He is a stay-at-home dad minding my two nieces. You know what I mean? Yeah. So he has a lot of time to do the podcast while he's watching them. He can work on stuff. So yeah, he's the best guy to message. I that's how you guys like are connected, right? You guys are talking.
I've been shooting shit with him for a week.
Yeah, buddy. Yeah. Just keep him going, bro. He's a great guy. And honestly, bro, he'll like but he will help you with anything, man. Mm-hmm. If he's engaging, just keep engaging with him, bro. Cause I'm telling you that he has everything good comes out with Danny's a part of.
And also I told him too, I'm going to send you guys out some merch. Some of our merch.
Dude, I will promote that so much, man. I love that stuff, man. That's so awesome.
I'll make sure I will probably have it out by the end of the week.
Unreal, bro. I'll wear it with pride, man.
Beautiful. All right, man. Thank you so much.
Have a great night, guys.
All right,
thanks, Sean. Really appreciate it, buddy.
See you, bro. Take care, guys.
And there he is, folks. The Sheriff Sean McMorrow. What an interview that was, dude. That jail thing, man. I was like, I'll be honest with you, I was nervous asking him because
that was crazy. I especially how you know, these guys fucking hosed him, and you know, he's one of the toughest guys that ever play the fucking game. And wouldn't you be afraid that he's gonna come find you?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would be afraid of,
dude. That Lindy Ruff story was awesome too. The shootout thing there, that was awesome too, man. So big shout out to the Sheriff Sean McMorrow and his boys over there at the show, the Sheriff Podcast. You guys can check them out. They're on all social media platforms. You can download his podcast anywhere, just like us. We're probably going to do some more stuff with Sean down the road. So
definitely going to be a part two to that.
Yeah. You're definitely going to see him on the show again. He's already agreed to do it. So big shout out to Sean. You can catch him anywhere. And thanks again, my friend. So Rob, you had
that's two NHLers we've had on here that live with their moms.
Fucking guy always got to dig
him with his Sean and Scotty.
Yeah, that's so funny. So you said there was a bunch of like free agents that are still available, like there's some big names on the list still, you said, right?
Yeah, there is. Like there's a bunch of UFAs still left out
now, like who?
So there's Tyler Bozak, like great centerman.
How?
I have no idea. Like, I don't understand.
Maybe a lot of teams are in cap crunch because it's a flat cap.
I don't know. Well, he's an unrestricted free agent, so you can negotiate a contract with him.
Yeah.
I'm sure he, you know what I mean? I don't think he's going to play for, you know,
league minimum.
1,000, but whatever. But you got Derek Brassard still. Valterio Filppula.
Oh, freaking Filppula is still available, eh?
Riley Sheahan.
Oh, Riley Sheahan.
Sheahan.
Yeah, former Red Wing.
Eric Staal.
Yeah. They're saying that Staal's probably going to sign again in Montreal. They're thinking that that might happen again. He's either going to Montreal or back to Carolina, they were saying, on Staal.
Really?
Yep. Go ahead, though. Keep going.
Mark Janikowski?
I don't know. I just love hearing you trying to say these names. Dash four.
All right, I'll just go with the names I know. Lucas Walmark.
Isn't Chara still available?
You let me go through it?
Oh, sorry, man. I just thought of him, though.
Travis Zajac.
Yeah, like what the fuck?
Like I
the list goes on.
So that those are all centers.
That's just centermen.
Yeah. So Jeez. Your wingers are Alex Chason.
Yeah. Former Oiler.
Yep. Ryan Donato. Yep. I think so. I don't know. Tyler Ennis.
Yeah.
Patrick Marleau.
He's still James not signed. Marlowe's still not signed, eh?
Nope. James Ooh. Neal.
Yeah, his numbers went way down, though.
Zach Parise.
They're talking that he was might be fuck, where was he linked to again? He was linked to like LA or something like that.
Okay.
Not sure
Bobby,
though.
Bobby Ryan.
I'm hoping he signs again with the Wings.
And the other three names I can't pronounce.
don't want to go dash five tonight. Holy shit.
Defenseman. Yeah. Zdeno Chara.
That's not
Jordy Benn.
Even though okay, let's take those two for instance, okay?
Yep.
Benn and Chara. They could go to a team like freaking like Arizona or something and play where they have lots of cap space, where they would be able to afford them. They would get great weather and they can go there and work with a bunch of young kids. Arizona coming up in the next 2 years and rounds one and two, they have like 10 draft picks or eight or around there in the first two rounds. Next year, I think it's the next year and the year after they have like 10 picks in the first two rounds. And the next few years are supposed to be some of the best draft classes ever coming up.
I don't know how you know that because there's been no hockey. So like, cause
I read a bunch of shit and I'm everywhere, bro. I poop a lot. So, you know, I got lots of time to read.
Eric Gustafson.
Yeah.
Michael Stone. And Sam, what is it? Vatanen?
Yeah, I think it's Vatanen, yeah.
Vatanen?
Yeah. Sammy okay. Vatanen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, man, it's big names, man. Like, it's crazy. Especially Z, because he's like a freak of nature, right? Like, he's a different breed, that guy.
How could you not just put him, like, on the penalty kill or... You know what I mean? Like, I don't know about the power play, but why wouldn't Arizona pick him up just for the penalty kill?
Well, that's what I mean.
Could you imagine the cross checks that he's giving you still?
He could run your power play.
For sure. Well, I don't know about the power. Yeah. I get
it's what fucking you're Arizona, yeah. Dude. Like, you know what I mean? He could go there and run a power play. He used to do it in Boston when he was in his prime. No.
So right? Listen to the goalies that are still available. God. Devin Dubnyk.
Yeah, crazy.
Marcus Hogeberg. Hogeberg.
I don't know who that is. I have no clue. What team is he with?
I'm probably saying it wrong anyways. Henrik Lundqvist.
Yeah, but they were saying he was up in the air because of that heart thing, right?
Yep. Curtis McElhinney.
Yeah, that one surprises me.
Tuukka Rask.
He's out till at least January.
Yep, and Corey Schneider.
Mm. Yeah, that's nuts, man. Well, Schneider.
Okay, but if you pick up Tuukka Rask, right, he's not on the books until he comes onto the ice, right?
Correct. Yes, because he would be long-term IR. So I don't think he would count against the cap until he comes back. But I think he's a heavy hit, though. Like, I think he might be a $6 or $7 million hit.
No, they're unrestricted free agents, so you just got to sign them
to whatever you want, but I mean, when you sign him, then when he plays and everything,
you $6 million,
you still have to pay him. Yeah, no, but that's just what he was at, so I don't know what the going rate would be when they're saying that
you're
sitting
on this list, you're not worth what you were.
They're saying he might just
asking too much and you're not getting what you want.
Well, that's why they brought in they brought in another goalie there in Boston just because they didn't know what the like situation was going to be with Rask, because he had to have like surgery, and they're saying that he's out till at least January. So it's long term, right? So that's the thing, and his age doesn't help as well either, right?
Your playoffs, like you're making a push for the playoffs in January.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like things, shit's starting to get
that much hockey. Yeah, I get what you're saying.
Shit's getting serious in January. You know what I mean?
Yep. But Curtis McElhinney, like, I don't know.
He could be a great fucking backup for someone. You want to know where he would be good at? Is like go to like Chicago, team up with Marc-Andre Fleury or something like that. I don't know who they have there as a backup in Chicago. Don't get me wrong, I don't follow the Hawks that much, but I just look at, I follow all the big guys, right?
Where was Devin Dubnyk?
He was in Minnesota. I know, I think he's played in Arizona. I think he's played in Minnesota. I know he's played there for
Minnesota. Was the last team he played at?
I think so. I know he was there for a long time. So it might have been. But like I said, I could be wrong on the Arizona thing too. I'm not sure. But I know he was in Minnesota for a fact. He was in Minnesota. Like one hundo.
So there's a lot of guys out there that are quality players that still aren't signed. Like Tyler Bozak. Like, I can't believe that.
Mm-hmm. I know that one surprises me too.
He was a Peter Zezel of the Toronto Maple Leafs. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
even him being a little older, like he's probably a little older, right? So he'd be a nice, but he'd be a nice, like third line center somewhere.
For sure.
Be a perfect third line center somewhere. And that's like Z, like you were saying too. Z would be a nice freaking bottom six guy for even a team that wants to make a push. Like, it's a little bit of a veteran.
You're seven.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So he's up always in the booth. He's rested.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know, man. I'm curious to see what guys will get signed. Cause did you know that there was almost $1 billion spent on the first day of free agent frenzy? There was over 240 signings. There was over $900 million spent. They said it was one of the busiest days ever. They said 240 signings. That's nuts, dude. Nuts.
Man, I would have been, bro, I would have been in the NHL if I didn't stand in the wrong line and asked to be this short. Mm-hmm.
Dude, did you see some of the deals? Like, hate to kind of change the topic here, but did you see some of the deals that the guys are signing in the NBA?
I don't watch basketball, like, because I said short, and you know I don't watch basketball because I'm short.
Steph Curry makes $54 million a season. The whole Buffalo Sabres fucking payroll is $53 million.
Did you see that the 2022-23 season that the payroll is going to be $83 million, I think it said?
Yeah, I think it goes up like a mil and a half.
It's going to be in the upper part of 83 million.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it goes up like a million.
Which is great for hockey, right?
Yeah, that's another guy.
Toronto could pay five guys $10 million.
Never know if that one mil rounds it up. That's crazy, man. All right, bro. You got anything else, or are you good to go?
No, that's it.
I'm tapped out too, bro. Surprisingly, there's kind of a lot going on.
I love scotch.
Surprise. But shockingly, though, for kind of an off week, there was kind of a lot to talk about. I was
pretty good. Especially when you said it's a slow week before we got started.
Yeah, like that was pretty nuts. Also today, I didn't forget, but I want to give a big shout out to my mom. It's her birthday today on the day we're actually doing this. It's Monday the 9th, so it's Mama G's birthday. So happy birthday, Mom. We love you.
Happy birthday, Mama G. You want to say happy birthday on the way out?
No, I'm not. I'm not
happy
a good thing.
Happy birthday to you. Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mama G. Happy birthday to you.
There you go. A little birthday surprise from Rob, a little birthday singing. So happy birthday, Mom. Love you, Mom. That you endured growing up with me and
God bless you.
God bless me and Drew. Couldn't have anything nice in the house. Me and Drew fucking broke everything playing mini sticks.
So. Now she has to put up with my shit too.
Yeah. So yeah, gets better. So on that note, I'm going to head out of here. Rob's going to head out of here until next week. The boys will see you next week. See ya.
Peace.
Yeah, I can get behind it.